There's one time when the Buddha asked Sariputta, "Are you convinced that the five faculties lead to the deathless?" And Sariputta said, "No, I'm not convinced, I know." Which means, of course, that when you're working from conviction, it's because you don't know. But that's where we all have to start out. We all start from ignorance. The Buddha himself, before he gained his awakening, was starting from ignorance. But he figured out how to come to knowledge. That's what he's trying to teach us. And as he said, in a student he looked for two qualities. One was that the student be observant, and the other that he be honest and no deceiver. So always keep those two qualities in mind as you practice. Being observant, what does that mean? It means you're inquisitive. You look for things that are not pointed out to you. You try to figure things out on your own. And the Buddha focuses you first on your own actions. Those instructions he gives to Rahula about examining your actions before, during, and after are basically instructions on how to be observant and honest, and where to focus your powers of observation, and to see where you should be honest with yourself, one, in terms of your intentions, and two, in terms of the results of your actions. So when we're meditating, we're focusing on the source of our actions. Always remember that meditation is about action. Sometimes we're told that it's not a matter of doing anything, it's simply being. But as the Buddha discovered, our being is becoming, and becoming is a kind of doing. And you want to be sensitive to that all the time. As you meditate, you're trying to develop three qualities that lead to knowledge. You're mindful, you're ardent, and alert. Alert to watch what's going on. Mindful to remember what you've learned. That's an important part of knowledge. We're not here just to be aware of the present moment and nothing else. Because we're looking for patterns. Patterns on our behavior that are unskillful, and ways in which we can change our behavior so it's more skillful. And for that, you have to look at things over time. Which is why there's the ardency in there. There's a strange passage in the commentary where it's trying to argue that ardency doesn't mean simply being aware of what you're doing while you're doing it. It says even jackals are aware. But how continually are jackals aware? How continually even human beings aware? They're focused here, and then they're someplace else. Then someplace else. Then they may come back here a little bit. Then they go off someplace else again. And how are you going to learn anything about your actions and their results if you're wandering around all the time like that? And how are you going to see patterns unless you can remember things? There's this quality of consistent alertness and ready mindfulness, focused again on what you're doing. Those are the qualities that will enable you to see. Because when the Buddha's teaching us the end of suffering, he's teaching us the path. There's nothing far away. It's all about what we're doing right now. And he's moving us from ignorance to knowledge by saying, be more alert to what you're doing. Be more mindful. Be more ardent. these are good qualities I have in mind in any case, even if it turned out that the Buddha was wrong. The fact that you had worked on these qualities as you meditated would stand you in good stead, whatever other tasks you wanted to do. So give yourself to these qualities. Give yourself to these actions. The path that we have conviction in is a good path. As the Buddha said, it's admirable in the beginning, admirable in the middle, admirable in the end. You start out with good practices. You maintain them. And they all lead to a good place. Now that good place at the moment is something that's unknown to most of us. But you can look at the beginnings. The Buddha teaches you to be generous and to reflect on your generosity. Same with virtue. You follow the precepts and you reflect on what it means to follow the precepts. This quality of being reflective, that's where you're going to learn. So when you're being generous, watch the mind to see what its motivation is, to see the parts of the mind that would argue against being generous, that would want to hold on to something even after you've given it away. And then see if you can train the mind to be more skillful. You begin to see the power of your action to shape the present moment and the future. Your observation is not a passive one, in other words, simply registering what's happening. You're doing and you're observing the results of your actions. Then you do some more and you observe the results of your actions. And you begin to see some of the forms of fabrication the Buddha talks about. You have to talk to yourself to be generous. You have to have a perception that it's something worthwhile. And same with virtue. You have to talk yourself into being virtuous. You have to see that it's worthwhile. You develop perceptions around your precepts to value them. That makes them stronger. Same as you try to develop goodwill. You realize that it's not going to come naturally. We're not simply uncovering our innate nature as we start trying to have goodwill for all beings. The Buddha never talks about innate nature, except for the fact that the mind is very changeable and is capable of all kinds of things. That's a nature, if you want to call it a nature, that's very unfixed, which means we can direct it. Again, it's through directed thought and evaluation, feelings and perceptions. And the realization that you have to be mindful around goodwill. You have to be determined on it. Making up your mind that you will have goodwill for everybody. And you hold that in mind. You don't slip in any other ill will and then pretend it's not there. And if you detect ill will, you've got to uproot it. Here again, you have to use direct thought and evaluation to remind yourself of why you have to do that, the advantages of that. And so as you engage in these acts of merit, you're beginning to see the mind in action. You begin to get a sense of what's skillful and what's not. Then you bring these qualities to bear. You focus on the breath, or whatever else your meditation topic might be. But here again, it's this quality of being reflective. That's where the Buddha has you focus your powers of observation on your actions, on your intentions, on the results of your actions and intentions. So you're looking here at what you should know best. This is where that commentary is really wrong. We are so ignorant about our intentions and so ignorant about our actions. And if the results of our actions are unskillful, we cover those up as well. If you go through life like that, there's no way you're going to develop any kind of insight at all. Here the Buddha is showing us how to examine ourselves. The image of a mirror appears again and again in the Dhamma. The Dhamma itself is a mirror. The practice is the act of holding a mirror up to yourself. And then you look into the mirror, and if you see anything unskillful, the Buddha says, treat it as if someone who's fond of beauty looks in the mirror and sees a blemish, sees some dirt on the face. You wash it away. And in doing this, you develop the qualities that enable you to know. So this is how you go from ignorance to knowledge. You observe, you do, and then you observe, and you do again. It's like learning a language. Each of us has had to figure out the English language for him or herself. When you're a child, your parents couldn't drill a hole in your head and put a funnel there and pour the words in. They would talk to you, and you began to pick up what they were talking about. It made sense. You asked, but then you were the one who had to ask the questions. You had to be observant. You learned grammar. How? By listening. And then you tried it out. And gradually, over time, you began to master the language. But you're trying to master the language of the heart, the language of the mind. For the purpose of putting an end to suffering. And so you do it in the same way that you learned your language, by being observant, speaking the language, listening to the language, trying things out. And you went from ignorance to knowledge. That's the same with meditation. The Buddha can't pour knowledge of nirvana into your head. If he could, he'd have everybody line up. And that's how he would have spent his life. What he did was taught people how to learn for themselves, how to find things out, and how to become more and more trustworthy as observers, putting those two qualities together, honesty and being observant. So the mind is put into a position where more and more you really can trust its judgment. It develops a better and better sense of what's right, what's just right. So this is how Venerable Sariputta went from conviction to knowledge. And this is how we can, too.